know how good I am at transitions. That was smooth, baby. What is going on, everybody? I know that we're just a little bit early here. I think we're 1 minute early, but couldn't wait any longer. I am so excited to bring to you another episode of Wake and Base, even though it's like, well, wait a second. Isn't it dinner time? Yes, but there have been crazy thunderstorms all day that have been messing with my power, and since I've already lost one monitor this week, I don't really want to fry any of my other stuff. So as you can see, I've got a little new setup here, and it's kind of a mess, but hey, we're going to do the best we can, and it's not going to stop us from listening to some fantastic music. Speaking of, that fantastic music that we are going to be listening to today is Ryo Fukui's first album, Scenery, which I just, you know, last week when we did our deep fusion jazz reality, it just wasn't enough. I needed some more. And so today we've got even more action with less people. That is right. We are dealing primarily here with a trio today. So we've only got a pianist, our Ryo Fukui, drummer, Yoshinori Fukui, no relation, and our bass player, Satoshi Denpo. Very interesting because as I've been doing some early research here today, couldn't find a ton of information on really any of them, mostly Ryo Fukui, and I found some very interesting reviews that talk about this album and how important it is, and we'll get a little bit more into that later. But something that I think will be fun that we can do is explore a little bit of the jazz culture that I have been fortunate enough to experience in my life and share that with you guys, as long as well, I can't talk, as one of my dad's favorite jazz musicians. So we get a little bit of Dad 63501 in here today. So there we go. All right, well, let's go ahead and pop in, see what's going on. Say hi to everybody. Hey, what's going on, Zal? Good to see you, brother. Good to see you. Hello also to Daniela and the popster, little poppy puppy. Kitsuki, how's it going? We got, oh yeah, if you haven't joined the Discord channel, come on over and join us here. We're hanging out in the chat having a good time. We've got Treesus in here. We've got Mark, the guy who made our fantastic intro video that we are actually still listening to right now. I'm going to turn Takanaka down just a little bit, even though it never deserves to be turned down. Yeah, we got Break, what's going on? For those of y'all who have not checked out all of the new videos that have been posted by our community, go check them out. I think we got one by City Pop Bass Me. I think we've got one here by Pop Bass Me, City Pop Dave. We've got a couple other artists in there. Anyway, I'm not going to try to recall them all right now because, as you can tell, I'm already struggling here enough to get the stream started. But in good form, I've already talked for 2 minutes. Let's go ahead and switch over to the old view. Say goodbye to Mr. Takanaka. Farewell. Thank you for your work here. And let's take a glimpse at what we're going to be listening here to today. Ryo Fukui. As I mentioned earlier, we're going to be listening to some jazz. And specifically, I think this is qualified as either hard bop or post bop. Let's see here. They got bop, modal, cool jazz. For those of you who do not know what modal means, that means a lot of times, especially in pop music, we deal with two modes, major mode and minor mode. Breaking that down to its simplest form, happy is major, minor is sad. However, there's five other modes in there. So there's seven classical modes. Let's see if I can pull out my old. So this is how I remembered it from when I was in music theory. I don't punch like Muhammad Ali. Ionian, Dorian, Phrygian, Lydian, Mixolydian, Aeolian, Ionian? Back to Ionian? I don't know. Something like that. Somebody look it up. But what that means is the scale sounds unusual. Sometimes it'll sound Middle Eastern, like what is often considered Asian music, a pentatonic scale, a five-note scale. Sometimes we've pulled that in for blues here in the American jazz culture. There are all sorts of examples we'll hear in here. But this is going to be a good intro here to this idea of what bop is. And we're going to be looking at some other artists like Thelonious Monk, Bill Evans, and a little bit, we'll see if we have time. I would like to look at Stanley Jordan, who is not a pianist, but has a very interesting version of Autumn Leaves, which is on this album. Now, that brings me to the next point before we listen to this album, and I promise we will start listening to some music. This is a 6-track album, and the first 5 tracks are covers, but not in our normal thought of covers. It's what we call a standard, a jazz standard. So what we've got going on here, it could happen to you, and I need to look up who wrote all of these. Early Summer is one I know. Autumn Leaves is a very famous one that I know very well, and we're going to compare some other artists. And then the one that he wrote is Scenery, which is the name of the album. So with that intro, let's go ahead and listen here to our very first track, It Could Happen to You. Again, for those of you just joining us, we're listening to Ryo Fukui, his 1976 debut album, recorded in one day, by the way. Here we go. Baseline. A tasty way to start it out. Woo. Man, this guy's got some amazing fingers. Listen to the drums. Not a lot of kick going on. If any. And for those of y'all listening with headphones, bass wonderfully mixed into the left ear, drums mixed into the right ear, piano right in the middle. Very nicely balanced. So one of the fun things about, we're talking in the Discord chat here about the really excellent mixing going on here. I'm going to turn this down just a little bit here. I know it's a crime. But with this mixing, as I was mentioning earlier, we've got our bass hanging out in the left, drums in the right, piano in the center. So when I say that, it's not 100%, but when we tilt things, a lot of times they'll do things like 80-20 or 70-30. So they'll push it 70%. Volume more over here, and then 30%, and then flip that, and that's how you get that stereo sound. Now 30-70 might be a little extreme there, but that's the kind of idea we're talking about. What's fun about that is if you take one ear off and you're trying to learn a bass part, you pretty much only hear bass and piano. Or if you want to play bass, you take off the left ear and you've got piano and drums. So it's really, really fun when you're trying to play along at home, or if you're trying to learn something or isolate, especially when there's only 3 musicians here. Very, very cool. Oh yeah, and that walking bass line. Yeah, we have our master of research, Master of Al, hanging out. Our secret double bass aficionado trying to hide that from us. Ooh, yeah. Oh yeah, now that's, that right there, that is a solid start. solid start to what we're about to jump into here today. Okay, so first things first, I just want to again mention to those of y'all who, if you're talking in the chat and it looks like I'm not talking to you, it's because I only have one monitor, so bear with me here. I'm mostly hanging out in the Discord chat. So, an opportunity to join the Discord, link in the description here. All right, now, some interesting facts about this album. First thing that pops out in my mind from what I was reading is the fact that this album was recorded in one day. It was recorded on September 7th. Let me see if I can find exactly the day. Let's see here. September 7th on 1976. Okay, so it was released the same year it was recorded. And it took place in Yamaha Hall. And he led the trio. Here, I'm just going to read a little bit here from this article. This is Derek's music blog. So Derek'sMusicBlog.com. Go check it out. Give him props here. But let me just read this little quote. So, the recording of Scenery took place at Yamaha Hall, Sapporo, on the 7th of September, 1976. Pianist Ryoko Fukui, leading a trio that featured drummer Yoshinori Fukui and bassist Satori Denpo. Taking charge of productions were Masataka Ito and Ryo Fukui, who worked well together. And Scenery, like many jazz albums, were recorded quickly, with just a day spent laying down the tracks. This is how countless classic albums had been recorded during the 50s and 60s. So, this is not only super true and super cool, that part about many jazz albums be recording in one shot or one day, but that's because these guys have not only crafted these tunes or these standards or these charts, but they have internalized it so much that they know what they want to do, not in a I'm going to sit here Alex63501 style and tab out the song so I can play it the same every time. No. This is like having a skeleton structure of something that you want to paint unpainted, totally blank canvas. And then they go in there knowing how they want to shape something, but there's so much improv and so much fluidity. A lot of times when you hear these songs, they don't do it the same way twice. So we have something called the head, which is like our theme. And then after we present that and we present our little solo section, what that sounds like with a theme on top of it, then we go into the free improv section. So in our last song here, we had a chord progression as a theme with a single note melody on top of this. Bum, ba ba da dum, bum, bum, ba ba da dum, ba 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 ba, ba 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 ba. That's it. And then he starts riffing on top of that, doing all sorts of stuff, going all over the place. Bass player, drummer, keeping him grounded, keeping him centered. And then he comes back to the head and he plays it again. And then we have that wonderful little outro there at the end. Okay, so that's one interesting fact about this album. And now one more interesting fact before we go into our second track. Ryo Fukui had no formal training on the piano, at least at the beginning. He is self-taught. So he decided at the age of 22 to begin teaching himself how to play. And apparently some of his friends were telling him, like, this is not a good idea, man. Piano is too hard to teach yourself. Like, not good. And he had weird hand technique and all this kind of stuff. Spoiler, as we look ahead, Thelonious Monk, another phenomenal jazz musician, had, from a trained, classically trained pianist point of view, some of the worst finger position you could imagine. But that did not stop him from getting unbelievably soulful and funky on the piano. I know it's like, jazz, hard bop, funky? My definition of funky is a very wide one, but it is excellent. Anywho, this guy pretty much taught himself how to play jazz piano. So when he was 22, let's figure out what year that would be. 22 would be 70. He did not play piano in 1970. He recorded this in 1976, 6 years later. Pretty amazing. Let's see what that sounds like with the second track, I Want to Talk About You. Here from our 1976 album by Ryo Fukui. Sensitive now, y'all. So here's the head. In introducing what the chords are going to be. Let me see if I can find a chart to this. So you can see, this is the melody, but these are the chords that are happening underneath. And so now, our drummer and our bass player enter, and they start supporting with these chords, and he can just start riffing and doing his own thing. Let's see where this song originally came from. Who wrote, "I Want to Talk About You"? Oh, yeah. Is this Up All the Way? Right, 1946 original. Billy Eckstein, okay. Oh, he wrote Stella by Starlight? Wow, cool. That's another great standard I love. Round Midnight, we're gonna listen to that later. Okay. Let's see what key. Now here's another thing with jazz. Keys, whew, it's hard to find a standard one because you can move around here. So right here, let's see. Looks like we're in either E flat major or C minor. I think we're in C, oh, look at that. C minor right there at the top. Let's see if we can find another one in a different key. Oh, that's nice and fuzzy. That's still in C. Oh, this one's in a different key. Oh, that's also the wrong song. I Want to Talk About Me. Oh, yeah. Another great opportunity to highlight how phenomenal bass players really set themselves apart from others. And in my mind, it's space. You have to... I cannot hold back. I always want to noodle more than I ever should. But when you're playing, you just want to outline the chords, support who's soloing or who's doing the main thing, and then occasionally fill in, but only as an answer. If the piano asks a question, it's okay for one of the instruments to answer. Like probably right here. We'll wait for the piano to ask a question, but then we'll hear the drums and the bass respond. See, now the bass is picking up a little bit more. It's like, okay, I hear what you're talking about. There was the bass's contribution to the conversation. Now the piano's like, okay, 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 I see what you're saying. Oh yeah, this is great. All right, hate to do it. Gotta turn it down a little bit. So, when we're talking about jazz and having a conversation, that was something a professor years ago told me that really stuck with me, is that you never want to be talking and screaming over each other. Unless, I mean, I guess there are moments when that is okay. But in general, you want it to be a conversation. You want everybody to participate, but everybody has their role in the moment. As far as who's leading the conversation, somebody who has something to say, a reaction to something that is being said. And this can happen in a piano, right hand to left hand. You can hear the chords in the left, very relaxed. Right hand is voiced much more out. There we go, yeah. bass supporting us. Again, we got that left-right mix. Just so smooth. Very, very down-tempo. This is where we get our cool jazz in the title there. And here's one of our outros, I think. Bass giving them space. Didn't even play there. No, ended on the 7. Duh. Bum. Oh, there it was. That hi-hat. That was the resolution because he ended it on the 7. Duh, instead of going bum. That was sweet. That was sweet, Morty. Okay, very cool. Very, very cool here. So, jumping back a second here, talking about how this album is a collection of covers, with the exception of the last one. And when we're talking about jazz, we don't really use the word cover. We use the word standard because we have a standard notation for the song that we're talking about. And the one that we were just doing, let's see if I still have the paste in there. Good. I want to talk about you. This was originally written here. Let's see if we can find who we just had the original person here. Let's see here. Ba, 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 ba. Here we go. I want to talk about you chart. Here it is, Billy Eckstein, 1946. So according to jazzstandards.com, that was where this came from. And if we look at a image here, we can just briefly see what a chart looks like. So we've got our head. It's not very clearly outlined here, but the head is the melody. So we've got our melody going on here, got a page of it. And then we have all of these chords, and we're in C minor up here. So what happened at the beginning of our song is Ryu played through this whole page. And he did some extra things there, maybe embellished a little bit, but mostly followed this form. Then, when the drummer and the bass player entered, the bass player harmonically was supporting what was going on here. The drummer is rhythmically supporting what's going on here. But the pianist, our soloist, is doing whatever he jazzy feels like. And he is jazzing it up on us, keeping it nice and smooth. And as we were talking and exploring in that song, we can really hear a lot of the conversational qualities of how they play together. Again, using the rhythmic interplay of the bass and the drums, as well as the harmonic reinforcement of the drum, of the bass, I guess a little bit of drums, and how that works together with the piano, and how even within the piano, right hand, left hand, we're voicing that differently. So we're taking this trio and expanding the possibilities of how many people are in this conversation. It's not just three. Sometimes it's one. Sometimes it's two. Sometimes it's four. Maybe later we'll hear five. I don't know. We'll check it out. But let's go ahead and see what we have here for our next track, Early Summer. Let's go ahead and look up Early Summer and see if I can do jazz standard. Oop, don't look at my spelling. And see what we can find as far as who wrote this one. Okay, Early Summer, Hideo Ichikawa. And look at this. So if we go to the Wikipedia page, if I had just done the thing that I said I was going to do earlier, let's look at this. Scenery, here we go. Boom. Let's just read the Wikipedia article real quick because it is extremely short. So the album was virtually ignored in the U.S. as it came out at a time of reduced interest in jazz in America, again, 1976. However, it was well appreciated by Japanese fans and critics alike. In the decades since Scenery's release, the album has earned greater critical praise. Fukui's dexterity and self-taught style has earned him comparison to such piano greats as McCoy Tyner and Bill Evans. Very cool. Now, I don't know who McCoy... Now, is it Tenor or Tyner? I'm not sure who that is. I'm going to have to explore that later, but I wanted to show you guys some Thelonious Monk later when we get to Autumn Leaves, when we can talk about all the different permutations and existences of Autumn Leaves. We're going to do that. But this track, which is our last track on side A, was written by Hideo Ichikawa. And I'm going to have to look up and see who that is because I'm not at all familiar with that name, but I'm sure that I should be and that we're going to learn a little more later. So again, for those of you joining us here, we're listening to Ryo Fukui, jazz pianist, 1976 album here. This is his third track, last one on side A, Early Summer. Let's see if we can find a chart for this. this is Rosemary. Some extra percussion now. Ooh, and there's our bass player, baby. Al, you're being too kind. Please listen to your professors. Don't listen to me. Master of Al is one of our bass players in the channel here. He's classically studying not in America, so I'm always interested to hear our international opinions on jazz, so keep it coming. Also, Mark, in our, here I'm going to turn this down a little bit, I know this. Whew, we got a lot of splashy drums in this one, which I love. Finally, our percussionist, our drummer, is coming out here. And let's look at his one more time. Yoshinori Fukui, no relations. And this guy, man, because these, and here's the other thing I haven't gotten to bring up until right now. This is what, as far as I can tell, these cats did. Wow. Oh, now that was, that's a change. I'm going to have to Alex63501 rewind because I was talking over something too much. Ah, this is a really neat chordal change here because they're just so open, holding on two chords, going from the two to the one. And then somewhere here. Is it here? I like that. I like that. Okay, so as we're still going here, another person in the Discord chat here. Ah, there it is again. I love that. I bet that's part of the head. It's got that glissando, not a glissando, but that, you know, scale going up. Oh, that's fantastic. Yeah, so Mark is talking here about minor swing. It's a gypsy jazz standard, which is another version of jazz. Gypsy jazz, oh, that's super tasty. As a violinist, that's the one area of jazz that I get to participate just as much as everybody else does. Gypsy jazz, I'll have to do that on the channel sometime. But yeah, he's talking about a conversation. Everybody has time to shine. Everybody has time to sit in and sit out. It's super important to learn your place when you're playing with other people because unlike something like a rock band or if you're producing a track where you pre-do all the levels, it's very tempting to just constantly play out loud and really scream. But the best musicians, the best ensembles know balance. Balance and silence. That's what, or not silence, but just space. I'm going to stick with space, because you can still have sound without being busy. Like right now, I'm going to stop talking with my busy mouth and listen to some Ryo Fukui. Hey, what's going on, Sticky One? Layla, good to see y'all. Happy 63501. Oh yeah, baby. Well, you see, he's not even playing that fast. He's playing two notes. Dum ba-ding bum bum ba-ding bum bum. And the drummer's not doing that. So we got one rhythm bump, but I'm bum bum, but I'm bum bum, but I'm bum bum. And over here. He's just switching it up. Okay, so we got the... Okay, for the crash ride. And then in the middle, Ryu, everything in between. I've heard him do triplets, fours, five, six. These are 16th notes. Yeah. Can't stop, won't stop. Yes. Oh, man. Okay. I got to keep talking over this. Otherwise, I'm just going to listen to this all. I'm going to get so many copyright strikes as it is. Anyway, this guy is self-taught, people. Okay. He messed around with an accordion. He messed around with an accordion for like 4 years before he picked up the piano and did this in 6 years. So to anybody out there who's like, I don't know if I want to wait. No. Start. Very, very cool here. Alright, so as we were looking at this song here, Hideo Ichikawa, jazz pianist, is the one who composed this piece for us. And so this, even though it's a cover, I'm going to go ahead and call this a standard, because this has a really good vibe to it, really good feel. And as we're looking at what he's composed here, he has written a lot of things for a lot of people. Let's see where we... Kicks all the way back to 1967 with the George Otsuka Trio. That's pretty neat, okay. And as we go through here, let's see what we end up with on page 4, one of our last pages. Ooh, hey, we got a drum solo. Oh, there we go. Oh, look at that. Colin took the words right out of my mouth. Yep. I still love it, Cohen. Keep dropping those knowledge bombs. Oh, man.
Oh, no!
This is a crime. He's only with these guys. Guy's getting it. Damn, okay. Anybody out there who's ever played not only percussion, but if you've had to play with the percussionist, you can appreciate what is going on right now. Because this cat has just kept... I don't know what rhythm this is, like 130 or 140, whatever, but nailing it. And every single hit. Listen to that. I mean, we're still mixed right, like... There's a little bit in the left, but man. Man, that gets a clap 50 years later. Yes. That was awesome. That was awesome. Okay, so, and now we're back into the head. So this is that main melody of the song. Whew, all right. So looking at our cat here, he was writing stuff, or it looks like he was actively doing things till at least... It looks at 2012. I can't tell if these are reissues or re-releases or things like that, but my goodness, what a career. Hideo Ichikawa. So he's the guy who originally wrote this track that we're listening to here. All right, I'm going to turn that back down for a second here. Okay, so as we've talked about here, looking through as we're getting ready to move on to our second side of the album, three standards at the beginning here. First one, It Could Happen to You, written by Jimmy Van Heusen and Johnny Burke. Our second track, I Want to Talk About You, which was... very down-tempo, very, very chill. That was written by Billy Eckstein, 1946. And this last one, Early Summer, written by Hideo Ichikawa, I'm going to guess this was written sometime in the late 60s, early 70s, because we saw his first writing credit was 1967. And I'm going to leave that to one of you Alex63501 stunt team members. If you're really interested, you can find that information on when that song was written or when that was released, and I'd be happy to share that with everybody else here. Fantastic. Oh. I like that. Master Val, one of his professors, says... This professor always says, I can play every instrument. It's just difficult to make music on different instruments. I love that. Oh, that's good. That's a good ending, man. You see, that's why I'm not in jazz bands, because I would have gone tick-a-da-boom. Too much. They knew when to stop. They knew when to stop. Awesome. Yeah, man. Colin's talking about it's inspirational. This is absolutely inspirational, man. It is never, ever, ever too late. Here's another thing that I really love about Ryo that I like to think I'm following at least a little bit in his footsteps. Even though I'm a classically trained violinist, and since there's some interest in me playing violin, yeah, I'll break it out. I am self-taught on bass. So I had about 1 year of lessons on guitar and bass when I was 16 from a really phenomenal bass player in the Midwest named Mike Tripp. If you ever get a chance to check him out live, I mean, he's like a blues myth. The dude just like shows up in different bands all over the Midwest and just unbelievable. I mean, I think of him as the Jimi Hendrix of like blues, rockabilly, rock, bass. He's gnarly, and he's like the nicest dude on the planet. And he's got this massive beard, looks like ZZ Top, he's great. Anyway, point is, I was able to use information that I gained from my classical music, from my friends that I played with, all this kind of stuff. And then when I started doing this bass channel here, I've gotten so much better in 4 years just from continuing to try, watching YouTube videos, getting encouragement from you guys here. And it goes back and forth, man. It makes me feel so good to see people like City Pop Dave and Master of Owl who upload all these. We are fueling each other to, you know, really create and make more things. And it's awesome. It really feels good. So for all of you who are not in the Discord community, get in the Discord community. It's a great place. And for those of you who think it's too late, it's never too late. Never, ever too late. Okay, let's jump back in here. Spook. Yeah, Mike Tripp. Look him up, man, if you can find him. I'll never forget. Okay, the last little story. I think I was 16 or 17 years old. It was right when I was still studying with him. And there's this thing called Round Barn Blues Festival. And we all went there, and he was playing on stage. And I just remember seeing him play with this band. Band was fine. Like, it was okay band. Nothing too crazy, but Mike was doing his thing, laying it down fresh, holding on. Then at the end of the song, their last song was a rock song that was really cranking. And he is such a reserved dude. And he just turned into a beast. And he customizes all of his guitars. And so he had this, it wasn't a Rickenbacker, but it was like a knockoff Rickenbacker that he had, you know, modded out and put a Bigsby bridge on. So a bass with a Bigsby bridge. And he's just shredding this thing. And he gets to the end and he's doing like, he pulls out, does all these pop slap things, then grabs like chords, pulls the whammy bar, goes rips it off his body and slams it on the ground and walks off stage. And it was the most epic thing I've ever seen to this day. And since he was such a chill, like, he always talks like this. Yeah, how's it going? Stuck in my brain. I'm not going to tell you how many years ago that was because I'm old. But stuck in my brain, I will never forget how awesome that was. And the guitar was fine. Not that I'm going to suggest you guys do that, but that was also why he didn't use a real Rickenbacker. I'm from Missouri, man. We have hillbilly instruments. I played a show one time on a $35 guitar. I tried to smash it at the end. It was not good. Okay, enough fun time stories back from the 1980s. Let's go ahead and switch into the B-side. So now we're going to listen to Willow Weep For Me. Now, this one is written by Anne Ronnell, and I'm so happy to say that we have a female composer being represented here who is almost always female composers are underrepresented. They write stuff that's just as good. So, fantastic opportunity to hear what she's got. with Ryo's spin on it here. So, one more time. This track, Willow Weep For Me, originally written by Ann Ronald. 1932. Ooh, yeah. There's some bass, baby. There we go. See if we can find where we are. Are we in one of the breaks here? Let's see here. Jazzer. But anyway, here's the chords. So as a bass player, all you gotta do is just chill on these chords. Got a little walk up at the end there. G, C, G, C, G, A, D, G, A, B flat, B, C, A, D, G, E, A. The idea though, and he's not playing these notes all the time, he's just hitting what we call roots, which would be the bass chord. So if I'm talking about a root note, let's say I'm playing a C major chord, C, E, G, three notes. Root is C, third E, which is C, D, E, and the fifth is G, C, D, E, F, G, fifth. So that's what we're looking at here, is we're looking at these big letters. Those are what we call the roots, or the main notes. Now, all those other things, like a little triangle, I think that means diminished seven. Or maybe it's the circle that means diminished. That circle, yeah, the circle is diminished. Circle with a slash through it is half diminished. There's flats. Those sevens mean you add a seventh. It's like a code. It's its own little language, and it looks very intimidating. It is not that bad. It really is not. You think you have to be a theory genius to get it? No. You just gotta spend time. It's never too late. Never too late to get going, to start. Speaking of late, Pop Bass Me, I'm late. You're never late, Pop Bass Me. You're always right on time. And everybody else, if you have not listened to Pop Bass Me, go over to his channel right now. You can keep listening to this. Just go over. You got tabs. Subscribe. Listen to his new stuff. It's excellent. Very, very good. So, we got a good question here. What is the difference between bluesy jazz and gypsy jazz or other jazz? It's a great question. It kind of goes into a little bit of our talk of city pop, where city pop is not so much of a genre as it is a time and place, blah, blah, blah. You've heard my definition of that a billion times. With jazz, it's the same thing. Cool jazz and hard bop are extremely different from gypsy jazz to fusion jazz, Cassiopeia. You know, jazz is a huge umbrella. So if I had to tack down what makes jazz, jazz is probably having a chart or having it be based around improvisation. Like a big element of it is improvisation. Not all the time, because again, you look at something like Cassiopeia, where their stuff, their fusion jazz, is very much written out, but they still have they have room for improvisation. Nothing like this, but they still do, and it's a different thing. It has, you know, no judgments here. I love Cassiopeia. Also, Cassiopeia entire discography, I believe, has just been uploaded to Spotify. So I'm not paid promotion by Spotify. Spotify, give me free stuff if you're listening. But go check it out. That's a great place to hear all of their music in super high quality. Way better than YouTube. Sorry, YouTube. Anyway, very, very cool. All right, let's jump back into this. I'm going to stop talking. Let's listen to this a little bit. This is chill. Oh, yeah. I love our Discord chat. So much knowledge in there. Mark hooking us up with good Paris jazz talk. I'm going to read a little bit about Ann Ronald here. Ooh. All right, breaking it down. I like it. I love that lick. Oh yeah, that rhythm. That's another jazz thing. Being out of time is totally fine as long as you have an entrance strategy. You gotta have an exit strategy and an entrance strategy. So if you know I'm going to go from this chord to this chord, like right here. Bum, I know the next chord's there. So the next time I can go. Wow. If you set points for yourself, you can then do whatever you want in between. Within reason. Within reason. Dropping it back to the intro here. Okay. Man, that's such a great bass line. Man, these guys, it is a shame that they only released what appears to be three albums. And they worked always as a unit. If we look at their discogs here, all three of these cats, this is their discography right here. So Ryo plays in some other things, but there we go. Let's see how they end up with a seven. Okay, they actually resolved. I thought he was going to end it on that. Ding, da-da-dum. Just one. Very cool, very, very cool. And again, adding that flavor, adding that spice, because there's just so much room. And one of the great things about the what can be intimidating, but really is just the freedom of it, is that you have freedom. You can choose what to do, and as long as you know what you want your center points to be, whatever those, either the tonics or the roots of your chords, or if you want to highlight a different melody, or all those kinds of things like that, you've got those options. Okay, now, little parting words here about our composer for this last piece, Ann Ronald, a female American composer who wrote this, Willow Weep for Me, in 1932. Very sad that in most terms, not just classical music and jazz, but in a lot of history, women composers have been written off due to patriarchy, things like that at the time. It's a real shame. So any chance that I get, at least, an opportunity to talk about somebody who wrote something as cool as that, I'm going to do it. So on top of that, she wrote Who's Afraid of the Big Bad Wolf, 1933, another hit that I'm not familiar with, but definitely going to check out later. Just kind of going through some of the highlights here, she interviewed George Gershwin, struck up a friendship, and then she was hired as a rehearsal pianist for one of his shows. So that's very cool, a very cool connection there. Working alongside Dorothy Fields, Dana Seuss, and Kay Swift. Kay Swift, I don't know these other two, but working in Tin Pan Alley, which is a huge hotbed for jazz in the 30s. What does it say here? In the 20th century? Yeah. And this is a big place where a lot of these artists came out of. And then from this, we had that big spreading out and offshoot of hard bop, jazz, you know, post bop, well, all these other things. I don't know all the names. I'm bad. But as I was looking through here, the legacy of some of the people that have recorded her songs, Billie Holiday, Cab Calloway, Louis Armstrong, Ella Fitzgerald, Barbara Streisand, Frank Sinatra, Nina Simone. These are all massive names. Ray Charles, Tony Bennett. Oh, my goodness. Oh my goodness. What do we have here? Ooh, we have a chart that I'm going to be exploring here in a second, put by our master of research. But before we go too much further into that, let's go ahead and go into this next song, which is the one I have been anxiously waiting for, Autumn Leaves. And this is where we are going to make some divergence here towards the end here. But this is a, from what I've heard, because I haven't listened to this in a while, if I recall, this is maybe a little bit on the slower side for an interpretation of Autumn Leaves, but that's what's great about Autumn Leaves. It works whatever tempo you want to do. So let's hear, for those of y'all here just joining us now, we're listening to the 1976 album Scenery by pianist Ryo Fukui and his trio. And this is his version of Autumn Leaves. This is like Pink Panther intro. So this is our head. And you see, he's doing it jazzy. In it, baby. And there we go. He takes it away. Ooh. So this is a chart we got here. Let's see what we have. Okay, so this is looking like a American chart for jazz, and following that out of the New Orleans tradition, which is a huge tradition here in America. New Orleans and Chicago. Okay, I was going to say Chicago. All right. That seems early for boogie. Kansas City. The Kansas City shuffle. The Kansas City had swing. Yeah. Okay, 1940 is kind of hard to see. Bebop. Traditional jazz. So traditional jazz, I guess, is up until 1940s, according to this chart. And then modern jazz goes until, looks about the 80s. And then we have postmodern jazz. I always love when they use postmodern, because it's like, you couldn't come up with anything else. Like, I know modern is a movement, but you kind of goofed by calling it modern. What's now? Postmodern? What's in 10 years? Post-postmodern? Sure you don't want it to be called Galacticon? The Galacticon era? Ooh, look at that! Talking about Clara Schumann. I like this. You're making my classical music senses tingle here. Oh yeah. Robert Schumann, they were married. He had his own article. Clara Schumann, another interesting example. She would write as George Sand. No, hold on. I'm sorry, that's somebody else. That's Chopin. Or no, maybe it was Clara Schumann. I think, yeah, she wrote as George Sands. She wrote music under a male pseudonym to get her stuff put out. I hope my dad's not listening. He's gonna crush me if I'm wrong on that. He knows a ton about classical music. Way more than me. And here we are, back to our intro. Bum, bum, bum. Hey, bass solo. Ooh, all right, now we got a new one. If you have to ask, you'll never know. I would say the first chart that was posted there, Al, was a really good chart for like Midwest North American kind of jazz. But this is, just kind of putting names out on here more and sticking more internally to from 1910 to 1960. Because once you get the fusion here, post-60s, it's anybody's game, because you have some traditionalists, you have some new wave, fusion, free jazz. Oh, there you go. Sun Ra. Yeah, okay, good. I was like, they didn't put some. Sun Ra and his orchestra. That cat is crazy. If you think George Clinton is crazy with the Funkadelics, he got all of that from Sun Ra, man. Chet Baker, Dave Brubeck. If you like me some Dave Brubeck. Yep, Gypsy Jazz, Stu Cabelli, Django Reinhardt. Interesting fact about Django Reinhardt, a gypsy who, he was in a terrible fire. I'm not sure if he went back in to go save one of his family or if he was just stuck in there or whatever, but it caused neurological damage in his left arm. And he was a guitarist, and that's terrible. I don't think I need to tell you why, but he couldn't play with his bottom two fingers. But again, theme of the day, not letting any of that kind of crap stop you. He just used two fingers. So we're going to listen to a little bit of Django Reinhardt playing later, but he would just go, two fingers. No excuses, everybody. But no, these are both good charts. Thank you, Al. These are both excellent. Again, if you want to check them out, join the Alex6501 Discord. It is free and it is tasty. Just like that outro right there. Get that close right there. Fantastic, fantastic, fantastic. Okay, now, I want to go ahead and just play this through to the last track, because we've finally gotten to the track written by these three. And this track is called Scenery. So let's go ahead and listen to this last track here, and then we'll go back through, and we'll look at some of the other things, talk about autumn leaves, things like that. But I've been anxiously waiting to hear this track. Artist has sampled this song, and the song is called Bong Water. Just died a little inside. What's up, Amaru? Welcome. Ah, this album is so good. We got five or six samples from this album, but only one from this actual song. This is reminding me of our second track, I Want to Talk About You. It's our cool jazz laid back. Pong water. Yeah. The chat's exploding. Exalted by proxy. Yeah, we're going to have to listen to it just to satiate our curiosity, but I'm not super stoked on that. But here's our bass player one more time. Satoshi Denpo, teaching us all a masterclass in space. We have a question in the chat. Bong water, like the water in a bong? Yes. Like the water in a bong. If you've ever seen the movie Idiocracy, when he's like, why don't you guys just drink water? You're like, what? Water? Like from a toilet? That's gonna sound really weird if you haven't seen that movie. Subscribe and like! Okay. I'm sorry. Thank you for asking. Doing better now that you asked. There's that little jazz trill I love again. It's going from that one to the minor three, major three, minor three, one. Talk over this because it's just so fantastic, but gotta give YouTube less reason to say that I'm not altering content here. So, some of the legacy of Ryo Fukui, let's just talk a little bit about what he's done since this album and what he's been a part of. So, I am 1000% wrong, as always with Awaken Bass here. Yoshiniro Fukui is in fact Ryo's brother. So this is almost a family trio. I bet they consider the bass player part of the family. But as we look here, let's just read a little bit of the Wikipedia article. Oh, Amaro, you're being so kind to me. I'm glad my video's gonna help. 6 years after moving to Tokyo in 1976, he released his first album, Scenery, and his second album, Mellow Dream, the year after. He continued improving his skills over the following years in live performances, often appearing in a trio including Satoshi Denpo, Yoshinori Fukui, his brother, and himself. The trio would often play at the Shinjuku Pit Inn, a sometime jazz club, and the Jazz Inn Lovely in Nagoya. Fukui also began to perform overseas in France and America, as well as beginning to teach jazz piano to students internationally. So that was all the way through the 80s. So in the 1990s to 2015, by the way, he passed away 2016, F in chat here. 1992, during his visit to America, Fukui met Barry Harris, an American jazz pianist from Detroit. The two went on to become close friends, and Harris becoming a mentor figure to Fukui and helped him develop his technique into bebop. So in 1994, a third album, My Favorite Tune, was recorded and released, featuring Fukui on solo piano, playing several original works, as well as renditions of songs such as My Conception by Sonny Clark, After Hours by Avery Parrish. This album was followed by In New York 4 years later, and his trio with the drummer Leroy Williams and the bassist Leslie Atkinson. And there we go, and that's the end of the album, Scenery. Very cool. Well, you know what? Since we got some time and I want to keep reading, let's just hear a little bit more of that. Just a little bit more. I don't think anybody's going to complain too much here in the background. Very chill song. I love this. Okay. So, the album, In New York. After that, in 1995, Fukui went on to open the Slowboat Jazz Club, which attracted many local jazz players as well as international players. He would also go on to offer lessons and workshops and pass his knowledge on of music to others. Fukui's final album, A Letter from Slowboat, was released in 2015. Recorded live during his time at the Slowboat Jazz Club. Okay, I'm definitely checking that out here in the future. Fukui died on March 15th, 2016 of lymphoma. After his death, his widow, Yasuko Fukui, took over the Slowboat Jazz Club, running its day-to-day operations. Fukui's longtime friend, Barry Harris, has since been seen playing his song, Fukai Aijo, and dedicating his performance to Fukui. That's sweet. That's real nice. Online presence. In recent years, Fukui's music has made its way into popular internet culture, as much of his work has been uploaded onto popular streaming sites such as YouTube and Apple Music. The resurgence of Fukui's works has cultivated a large audience of collectors seeking the vinyl releases and releases of his work. Pretty cool. And accolades. So he received the Sapporo Culture Encouragement Prize in 2012. I have no idea what that means, but good on you, buddy, man. Your music is awesome. Very cool. And here's a picture of him a little bit older in life, looking very much like a distinguished jazzer. I love it. Jazzers always have a very, very telling style. They're either very much looking like they are just absolutely on the fringe of 1940s society, wearing like a three-piece suit, smoking cigarettes, skinny as a rail, or they look a little bit like this cat, which is just kind of like your average dad kind of looking dude, maybe professor, maybe the shirt doesn't fit quite right, But man, you put him in front of an instrument of any kind, and it's just all over the place. So good. Okay. And that's a better place to end it right there. Okay, very cool. All right. So, absolutely fantastic album from Ryo Fukui, 1976, Scenery. So that last track we just listened to, title track, Scenery, is the only one actually written by the trio there. The rest, I guess to be fair, they were all written by the trio, their interpretation, their live improv, all that kind of stuff. But these were jazz standards. And some of the more interesting ones that we looked at was Willow Weep For Me. Let me see if I can pull up this Wikipedia page one more time. Probably not, because I got rid of it. But we had some very interesting looks at our composers of these pieces, one of which was a female composer, which is always excellent to see. So the last thing I want to do here, though, is go back several steps when we were talking about how Ryo Fukui taught himself piano, and his technique was not uniform and would not be what we would call classical good form. But that doesn't mean anything, because what we just heard, I don't think anybody could be like, technically, I don't know if that's something that I really want to listen to. Like, no, shut up. However, the technique, people go, well, but it's limiting. Like, if you don't have good technique, you can't do all the other things. It might be harder, and nobody has explored it before, so you're going to have more work to do. But it's not necessarily always a bad thing to go do your own thing. This is Thelonious Monk. This guy, unbelievable hard bop jazz pianist. And he plays like the boy was born with no knuckles. But it allows him to get this action, this slap, that is just so him. I always thought this was called Round About Midnight, but it's just called Round Midnight. I'm just gonna scroll down here, give it a thumbs up right there. He was also known for wearing this little hat. It's a very Thelonious Monk thing. Let me see if I can go ahead and jump to some key solo here so we can hear some of his versions on this. See if we can get some close up of those fingies. And you see, it's not getting perfect, but it's that gesture moving down, and it's an affect, it's an emotion, it's a feeling, but it's so consistent. Anyway. I could listen to Thelonious. I could listen to all these people all day long. Now, I could not find a recording of Thelonious Monk playing Autumn Leaves, but I wanted to show you that style and then play for you a couple other versions of Autumn Leaves so you can hear just how varied a standard can truly be. So our version of Autumn Leaves was pretty slow and really stuck pretty close to our original chart as far as the melody staying very, very calm. So we had bum 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 bum. We didn't have a whole lot of swing. These next two we're gonna hear take a little bit more liberty with the what we call the head or the melody. That was a nice shot of a guy rubbing his nose there. That was weird. What the hell is this crowd shot? I have not watched this. I have not vetted this video. All right, can we get some Autumn Leaves now? Ooh.
Oh, yeah.
Mark's got some interesting info. Apparently, Tatsuya Yamashita, I think he had an album recorded at the Pit Inn. Very cool connection here. A little 2 degrees of separation to Kevin Bacon. Yeah. We got Mark talking in here. If you've never listened to the album that we just listened to today, you've seen it suggested. If you were on YouTube in 2016, you saw that little red cube on your sidebar. I'm like, I don't want to listen to a jazz album right now, but I see it. Now, who is this guy? Woo! Whoa. I'm sure we're all impressed, but I'm telling you, that's so much more impressive than even it seems. It's so in tune. Ooh. Oh, that tone control. Man. That finger strength. It takes some strength to play this thing. Nothing like double bass, man. Your fingers have got to be sausages. Okay, we can listen to this all day. Let's see Bill Evans play a little bit. See, now this guy, he looks like a just dyed-in-the-wool jazzer. Surprised he doesn't have a cigarette in his mouth right now. He would do that a lot. Just play with the smoke. So anyway, point I'm trying to get across here, he's playing a ton of chords. He's not doing that finger style. He's really doing chordal playment. That's Bill Evans, baby. He knows how to just flesh out a chord, make it interesting, put space in there. He's not a noodler. Here's an insight to Dad 63501. He doesn't like jazz noodling. He likes jazz precision. Like, I know what I'm going to do. I hear he likes the harmony. He's a harmony man. So, Bill Evans, if you ever want to make Dad 6501 happy. Ooh, chord planing. There you go. I'll give you guys the intro. Let's hear it. The drummer, you see, he wanted to do something, and then he stopped himself. Watch. See, and that guy's like, yes, the drummer did a good job. He did not step on Bill Evans. Good job. Okay, now this one is just for fun. This guy, Stanley Jordan. This dude just breaks all the rules. Stanley Jordan jazz is Stanley Jordan jazz. That's it. There's nothing else you can compare it to. Because this guy just decided, well, you know, standard combo, standard three-piece. That's pretty cool. But I'm a guitarist. And, you know, in jazz, guitarists often have to just kind of chill in the back with their amps turned to 0.5. And you got to make sure that you're hand muting and you're just finger style going chord, 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 chord. Can't play very much with guitar. He was like, that sucks. I want a solo, but I also want to play chords. So his solution, he straps a second guitar to a stand and plays two guitars at the same time. This guy's a beast. Left hand, chords, right hand, solo. You serious? You serious? How do I not have this life? And don't get me started on this guy in the background. Hey, what's up, Tatiana? Glad to have you join. I'm glad my videos can help. This is your next step. Just figure out, you know, Andrew, stay by me, and start doing this. Man, my internet's getting mad at me. I just can't stop listening to this because it's just such a good. Listen to that. Just how does he do it? All right. right, now let's go ahead and let's give the bass player a little bit of love here. Because this guy, I mean, his fingers are ridiculously big. I don't even have a hand signal for that. If he did what he's doing with his fingers to my table, he would just, like, start ripping holes in my wood table. Look at that. I can't even say full sentences, he's just blowing my mind. That's right, clap. Yeah, that walking line. Like I said, your fingers, I mean, this guy could probably, like, bend steel with his hands. It's a 30 years later clap just as well. All right, sorry, this isn't a drummer channel. That's mean. He shreds it too, man. But they do all these little fills here. Anyway, I could spend all day talking about Stanley Jordan. Maybe I will someday. Because eventually, as much as we all love the City Pop stuff, there will come a point where I have covered every Tatsuro album, every Henry album, every single Matsushita album. You know, there will come a point where it will branch out, as we have right now. But we'll keep doing it in an organic way, keep building that community. For those of you who are not in the Alex63501 Discord, please join it. It's such a fantastic community and has exploded into something beyond what I could ever imagine. I really have so little to do with it. I just open it up to gain enjoyment in the morning when I wake up and see what everybody's doing. We post people post videos of hard to find live recordings. They have really great music suggestions. We have a huge arsenal of other YouTubers and content creators, ranging from people who post these rare albums to people who do the exact same thing I do, making tabs, doing podcasts on video stuff, or on, you know, albums, music, things like that. We share tabs, music. It's just a fun place. We got a meme spot. It's cool. And if you hang out and you're nice to everybody, people like Mark over here will make you a really cool intro video for your channel. Sorry, Mark. Now I'm letting out word. You're doing stuff for free. No, I'm kidding. I paid him $1,000. See, now the next customer, you'll get $1,000. That's how we do it here. Okay, and for those of you who are hanging out in our chat here, so Amora, Tatiana, Layla, everybody else, colon parentheses, all that kind of good stuff. Thank you for hanging out. Come join the Discord. Come join. Okay, so we're done for the evening here. As always, a like and a subscribe lets me know that I'm on the right track. Ba 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 ba, standard outro video. Please let me know if you guys have suggestions for anything. Wake and Bass, for tab videos, for new content, all that kind of stuff. I listen. I'm very good at taking constructive criticism. Just don't call me too ugly. And yeah, last thing. I'm going to be switching formats a little bit for the live streams. I'm going to see, instead of doing YouTube live stream for our jams, this is all going to stay the same. But for the jams, I'm thinking about switching over to Twitch. Twitch music. So, if anybody has any insights or guides on how to get started with that, I think that might be my weekend goal. But until then, go ahead and give another listen to the Ryo album by yourself without me talking over it. And you guys have a fantastic, if it's dark outside, have a fantastic rest of your evening. If the sun's just coming up.